Kathy about some of that same tension, can we just acknowledge that perhaps this new story, this new narrative of creative leadership might be a little bit messy? Would you guys agree it's a little bit messy? And if we're going to figure this out and venture into that mess together for the sake of creating a better world, wouldn't it be fair to say that we want to do that with our fullest selves, all, as authentically as possible? Well, our final speaker in this session has amazing things to say about just that. She is a speaker, she is a coach, and she is a, I'm just going to go ahead and call it, soon-to-be best-selling author of an upcoming book. We're going to put it up on the screen so you can see it. It is a beautiful cover. I remember her showing it to me for the first time, and I was just like, yes, there it is. We're going to need cake. We're going to need cake. Celebrating authentic leadership in a messy world. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the summit, Valerie Garcia.
My very first leadership opportunity at work came unexpectedly, and I screwed it up pretty badly. I was very young, early 20s, and I had interviewed for a junior position. And on my very first day on the job, I walked into the office, and the person I had interviewed with, my would-be boss, I found out, had resigned the week before. Now, somehow, and to this day, 25 years later, I still couldn't tell you how that happened. I ended up in her role, managing a huge team of people, overseeing people, thousands of people, and what ensued was a comedy of errors, screw-ups, and let's face it, pretty big mistakes. So much so that one day, in the middle of a board meeting, surrounded by the VPs and CEOs of this company, I found myself shouting at my boss. So embarrassing to admit that. Now, this entire mess really came about because I believed so many of the stories that we have been told and that we continue to tell ourselves about what leadership really is. And we tell these stories because many of us confuse positionship with leadership. We think a title or a role or a position is the same as leadership. We aspire to get the seats at the table and get those roles and titles and positions. We think that getting one of those titles or roles or positions makes us a leader. And that is simply not true. Today, I want to outline the four biggest stories that keep us stuck in positionship instead of rising to leadership. Now, I heard some people in chat this morning saying, what if I'm not offered leadership? What if I'm not there yet? It's not about getting to a title. It's not about getting to a role. It's not about getting to a position. Now, maybe some of you are going to recognize these stories that I tell you today. You may have been taught these stories too. I know that I was. You may be telling yourselves these stories. I know that I told myself these stories, these untrue stories, for decades. And because I love a good visual aid, I want you to imagine that this sponge is you. And this bowl right here, this is your work, your business, your team, the people you serve, and the people that you lead. So we're gonna add some ingredients to our work today. And these are the stories that we tell ourselves that keep us from being real leaders. And first, we're gonna add some power. Now, this is the very first lie that we tell ourselves, the story that keeps us stuck in positionship. And this is the story that the power is all mine, that this is the entire goal of leadership, is to acquire power, that we want to get to the place where we make the decisions and we decide who sits at the table and we decide who gets to do what and who gets to do what when. And a lot of people approach leadership this way, but this is really positionship. This is getting to a seat at the table and not pulling up any other chairs behind us. This is simply just hoarding power. Secondly, let's pour in some certainty. Ooh, we love some certainty as leaders, don't we? Oh gosh, KPIs, all of the stats and the numbers. You know, the second biggest lie that keeps us from leading is that we just have to stay the course because this is how we've always done things. You know, that's the seven most expensive words there are. This is how we've always done it. These words keep us from truly leading. So now we're hoarding power and we're real sure that how we do things is the only way to do them. Now, let's add in some tasks. Oof, all the responsibility. Nobody can do it as well as I can. I need to do it all. It's all on me. I know best. It's easier if I just do this myself. In fact, it's so much easier that by the time it took to explain to somebody else how to do it, I might as well just do it myself. I know you're out there listening to this and feeling that twinge of, yes, I've said that before. Now, this leads to burnout. And worse, it tells our team that either we don't trust them or they aren't allowed to ask for help either. And fourth, you know, this is the big one. Let's pour in some emotions. Oof. But when it comes to this, let's talk about the story we tell ourselves. Never let them see you sweat. Fake it till you make it. We keep all those emotions in, and we tell ourselves that we can't let anyone see us struggle. So we shove all those emotions in a drawer, and we fake it. And that faking it keeps us from growing or learning or becoming the leader that we are meant to be. That looks messy. Looks kind of disgusting, actually. Here's the problem, remember? You're the sponge. You are the person stuck in positionship, and you tell yourself that all the power and all the certainty and all the responsibility and all the tasks and all the emotions are yours to hold on to. But do you know what happens to a sponge when it sits in that mess? Have you ever left a sponge in the dirty sink water overnight? I have. And do you know what happens to it? It starts to stink. And positionship does the same thing to us. When we try and hold on to everything and we believe all those lies, we stink. And I know, because my very first leadership opportunity, I did all of those things. I hoarded power. I clung to certainty, even when I was wrong. I refused to let go of tasks, and I alienated my team, and I acted like I had it all together, never asking for advice or for help. And I was stuck in positionship. I wasn't leading. So let's replace those old stories with new ones, truthier ones. Instead of hoarding power, we have to be brave enough to empower others. So we have to use our role and our title to bring others to the table and ensure that their voices are heard. We need to pull chairs up alongside us. Leadership isn't about gaining power, it's about empowering those around us. And instead of certainty, we have to start leading with curiosity. We ask questions like, what if? And why not? We encourage our team to take risks, even when the outcome isn't certain. You know, Harvard recently did a study, and most leaders they interviewed said, I want my team to be both creative and also curious. When they were really asked, most of them admitted they discouraged curiosity and creativity because they were worried that their team was going to make more mistakes. But when we allow those around us to be curious, magical things happen. Now, instead of hoarding tasks and responsibility, we're going to apply some confidence. Ours might not be the only way. We aren't the only ones who can. And by no longer telling ourselves this false story, we allow the people that we lead to stop hoarding the tasks too, and we empower them to ask for help. And lastly, and most importantly, we stop holding in all of our emotions. And we start showing authenticity. We start to show up as leaders, even when we don't have all the answers. We stop faking it because, you know, the biggest problem with faking it is that we might just end up faking it forever. This is how we go from positionship to leadership. Not by hoarding power, by empowering others. Not with certainty, but with curiosity. Not by hoarding responsibility and tasks, but with confidence. And not by holding on to emotion, but by being authentic. Now look, Is that still messy? Yeah, I don't know about you, but that's messy. The mess doesn't go away. We are all messy. But when you are brave enough to show up and lead messy, when you are brave enough to hand over the emotions and the responsibility and the curiosity and give up on the fact that I need to know everything and I need to have it all together and I'm the only one that can. By letting go of all of that, you give everyone around you the same opportunity. And by letting go, you don't stew in all that mess and start to stink. Now, I know you're hearing so many wonderful ideas about leadership here today. I've been sitting backstage all morning listening to all of the ideas about how we are going to fix a leadership crisis. And while I believe we absolutely have one, I also firmly believe that it's because a lot of us are stuck in positionship. A lot of us haven't even admitted that we are leaders. I know that was me. About 18 months ago, Harris will tell you that I sat on a call with him and I said to him, oh, no, I'm not a leader. No, my God, no. Oh, leaders, yuck. That's not what I want to be. Because in my mind, I was still thinking, leaders are the people that hoard the power and have to have everything their way and do it all one way and ultimately stink. There is no one way that we can solve a leadership crisis in one day or one afternoon. But if I can leave you with one thing today, it's this. Leadership is not about soaking it all up. It's about pouring it all out. That, my friends, is how we will make a difference. That is how we leave positionship behind and we become real leaders and joyful ones. And that is ultimately how we start to change the world.
So good. So, so,
so messy.
So good and so messy. And so messy. Okay. So I want to draw some parallels here. That was an incredible talk and it is resonating. I don't know if you were paying attention to the chat.
I'm not looking at the chat.
But everyone loves you and they love this idea. Tell me why you wrote a book on this very topic.
Yeah, you know, I wrote a book on this topic because for years I faked it and I hid my mess and I wasn't authentic and I was miserable and I really didn't enjoy my job. I didn't enjoy helping other people because I was so busy stuffing all of the realness down. Mm-hmm. But the day that I started showing up and saying, you know what? I struggle with depression. I don't always have joy. I struggle with certainty instead of curiosity. The minute I started saying, I'm messy too, mm-hmm. you know what happened? Like hundreds of people messaged me and said, oh my God, me too. I'm so glad somebody's saying it.
Yeah.
And I thought, you know what? This story needs to be told because I think there are people out there that think I can't be a leader because I don't have it all buttoned up. Like I don't have the people. I don't have all the answers. I don't have all the certainty. Good. Those are the kind of leaders we need.
Yeah. It's ironic, isn't it? Because I think a lot of times the reason we choose to not be authentic is because we're scared of that, what might happen if we do. But then when we get brave enough to do, the opposite ends up happening and we find acceptance and connection. It's really incredible. One of my favorite quotes is from Brené Brown. She says that choosing to be curious is choosing to be vulnerable because it requires us to surrender to uncertainty. Is it fair to say that being authentic has some uncertainty associated with it?
100%, it's all uncertainty.
Yeah.
Being authentic is embracing uncertainty. But the flip side of that, anything is possible.
Yes, anything truly is possible. All right, yeah. Where can people find the book? When does it come out?
It comes out August 22nd.
Okay,
very
so
excited.
We have to wait a few months.
Yes, pre-order will be open soon.
Yes.
And you can get on the list right now to get notified on my website at valeriegarcia.com/book.
valeriegarcia.com/book. All right, you heard it here. More appreciation. Let it flow. Valerie Garcia, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you so much.
I'm like, do we hug?
I don't know. I'm going to.
It's messy. We'll
embrace
the mess.
You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to take it all.
Oh, no. Just leave it there. It's messy. It's the end of the session.
It is so messy.
I just didn't want to like. Let's just embrace the mess.
Yeah.
Embrace the mess.
Thank you.
All right. Valerie, ladies and gentlemen. Amazing. All right. I hope this is a picture for you. That's why I started to leave it here. I'm like, this is a picture. Let this image sink into your brain. You are a leader. Is it going to be messy? Of course it's going to be messy, right? This event is messy and we're professionals. I've done over 2,000 events in my lifetime. This studio does events multiple days a week, week in and week out. It's still messy. We embrace the mess. This is what leadership looks like, right? And it's what you have the opportunity to put on display in your life. You don't have to wait to be qualified to be a leader. You don't have to wait for someone to offer you a position to be a leader. You just got to choose and decide. I'm going to leverage the story that I've been given and the wisdom that is the byproduct of living that story out to step up and lead. So if you look around and you're like, someone ought to do something about that. I'm going to say it again. Maybe that someone ought to be you. But that's not going to be just you. It is going to be in collective leadership, a collective journey with others as well. We need you, my friend. Okay, this is session two. We're not even done yet. All right, for those of you who upgraded tickets, in just a few minutes, we're going to be over in the sessions tab with a Q&A. We're going to take your questions for Valerie and Shane here in the studio. Networking tabs are open. Go check your schedule to make sure you're not late for session three, because you do not want to miss a single second of what's coming to you in our final session here at the Story Summit. Enjoy your short break. We'll see you again very soon.